This episode of the Linux Action Show is brought to you by DigitalOcean and by Ting. Go to last.ting.com and save $25 off your first device or your first month of service. Welcome to Linux Action Show, episode 328. My name is Chris.
My name is Matt.
Hey, Matt, good morning.
Good morning.
Are you ready for me to tell the folks about the big show today?
Heck yes.
Well, coming up in the second half of today's episode, Ryan C. Gordon, a.k.a. Iculus, is joining us to talk about the past of Linux gaming, the present of Linux gaming, the future, and anything else that blows his skirt up. It is a great chat, and we really got into a lot of details, including some recent controversies and a few other things like the future of the Steam OS and Steam boxes. It's a great chat.
Fantastic insights.
And not only that, since we're talking about gaming, to top it all off, PAX Prime 2014 is happening right now in Seattle, Washington. Our buddy Chase and his crew are down there. They're scoring interviews for us. We've got two interviews from the floor of developers that are designing games for Linux, and we'll play them in the news segment. On top of just that, in the news segment, we're also going to talk about the big upset at Red Hat this week. Rumors are flying like crazy, and everybody's got to write an opinion. We'll tell you what's really going on. And there's a few other things in the news that we'll chat about as well. It's not just Red Hat. Of course, John C. Dvorak has been trolling all Linux users.
Of course. That's what he does.
So we've got to come here and put a stop to that with our anti-trolling gun, which is our mouth.
In the back
of my hand.
That's
what I call this. Mine is my mouth.
Dvorak and I have had a...
Your anti-trolling gun is the back of your hand.
Yeah, Dvorak's an interesting beast.
But before we get to all that, it is our picks. And I have a personal one that... I spotted this week, and it was so exciting. I mean, really, seriously, like, how often does Chris come with his own runs Linux that he spotted in the wild? You know why? As I never leave the studio. So it's like everybody knows what we're on Linux.
His drones.
So this week was the Evergreen State Fair here in the beautiful Pacific Northwest. And when we're walking up to the admission booth to buy tickets to the Evergreen State Fair here in Monroe, Washington. Matt, what do you see up on that admission price screen right there?
Oh,
look at that.
That looks like Unity.
Look at that.
That's funny.
Now, this here is Chase got this picture. I wasn't able to score this picture. They did later install their updates.
Oh, did they really?
Not
good to advertise that.
The display booths at our local state fair.
That's awesome.
Run Linux. And we had a great time because we know we are here amongst friends at the Evergreen State Fair.
Right? You felt good about it.
Yeah, it was a good fair. And knowing that our tickets and our transactions were being dealt on Linux and not Windows XP, which it has been in years past, I think they made the change because of the end-of-life XP.
Could be.
Which is good. Now, the only thing, that same day, I did go to my son's new school, and they're running XP there.
Yeah, schools are kind of they're tough bag.
I know. I used to work for them. I know.
Yeah. You have better insights than 99%.
There's a better Linux alternative out there. It's called Linux.
That's right.
And it's better.
It's better.
Than
because
Windows.
It's Linux.
And it's Linux.
Yeah.
Hey, Matt, you know what else is Linux powered? That's our first sponsor this week. That's the great folks over at DigitalOcean. Go to DigitalOcean.com and arm yourself with some knowledge. This is the end of August right here. You see this, Matt? Look at that.
Oh my God.
The last day of August.
It's like,
right here.
I keep thinking, where's my summer going? Where's my summer?
So let's do this right. Let's rock last August while we still can. Let's be cool. Let's go in there and let's devastate their servers with support for the Linux Action Show by using the promo code LASTAUGUST over at DigitalOcean.com. Let's see if they can take it. They got a brand new office, too, so they might not be looking. Now might be your chance to rock support for the show, and they'll be like, what? Where did all these people come from? Why are all these droplets created? Oh, that's right. The Linux Action Show is rocking support. Go over to DigitalOcean.com. Let me tell you why you might want to do this. I love it, too. In our community now, when somebody needs something, like, we'll just spin up a droplet. It's like, it's become the go-to answer. Like, oh, yeah, we'll just create a droplet. And there's a reason for it. It's an amazing service. DigitalOcean is a simple cloud hosting provider dedicated to offering the most intuitive and easy way to spin up a cloud server. Now, you're like, oh, a cloud server, Chris. That sounds fancy. You're right. It is fancy. Check this out. Users can create a cloud server in less than 55 seconds, and pricing plans start at only $5 per month. That gets you 512 megabytes of RAM, a 20 gigabyte SSD, one CPU, and a terabyte of transfer connected to tier one bandwidth. DigitalOcean has data center locations all over the world. Multiple data centers in New York, San Francisco, Singapore, Amsterdam, and a brand new bad boy in London. The people are getting spin-up times under 30 seconds for their cloud server. And that's because their interface is simple. Their control panel is intuitive, and power users can replicate that control panel on a larger scale with their straightforward API. And you're like, what does that mean?
Yeah.
That means it's an API, y'all, and you can extend the functionality of the dashboard through that API. If you want to manage your systems with Puppet, you want to manage your systems with Chef, you want to do a Bash script, or you want to grab one of those Unity applet launchers that lets you control your DigitalOcean droplet, those are all using that API. That's why it's so cool. Your hosting provider has an API. And if you go to DigitalOcean.com and use the promo code LASTAUGUST, well, then you'll get a $10 credit. So you can get the $5 droplet for 2 months for absolutely free. Go try out OwnCloud, finally. You have snapshots and backups. If you mess something up, don't worry. You can recover it. You can go over there and download things so much faster than you could probably download them at your home connection.
Oh, yeah.
It's amazing the speeds you're going to get over at DigitalOcean.com. That means setting up OwnCloud and getting Ubuntu deployed literally took me under 10 minutes. It was incredible, and that's how easy it was to set up my own independent cloud. Same scenario for WordPress, BitTorrent, Sync. In fact, in some cases, like the case of things like GitLab.
Oh, big time.
WordPress. Ruby on Rails. They've got one-click deployments to Ubuntu, CentOS, Debian, or Fedora boxes. One-click LampStack.
Oh, it's the best WordPress experience I've ever had.
Well, and honestly, what's awesome for you is it's being managed in a very scalable system, in a very scalable way. If the blog gets big, you can scale up. If the blog gets small, you can scale down all through the simple interface. You can take advantage of things like Docker and Doku to make it all happen, running on top of KVM powered by Linux. DigitalOcean.com, promo code LASTAUGUST when you check out. And a huge thank you to DigitalOcean for sponsoring the Linux Action Show.
Loving it.
Okay, so our first app pick this week is to celebrate our guest. Braid is a well-known puzzle platformer with a very, very unique art style and incredible music. It's been available for Linux through the Humble Bundle, thanks to today's guest that we're going to talk to soon. Just this week now has hit Steam, which I know for you, Matt, it's kind of like, okay, it's in my zone. That's where
it's
I
in
work
my zone.
At.
It's my wheelhouse. That's
exactly.
Where I live.
Yeah, exactly. So Braid is an incredible game. I want to show it to you just for a minute. I've started it here. Let me pull it up. I have it running in the background. And I'm not like a Braid pro, as the kids would say, but I did come prepared. I brought my controller.
Oh, good.
Braid's
you
a great
got your controller
game.
All hooked up. Good now.
So,
there we go.
Yeah, so there's the music. It got. I mean, I love the music myself.
Love the art.
Yeah,
it's just gorgeous.
The art. Everything looks hand drawn, and it has some unique gameplay. So it's a platformer, if you're familiar with, like, you know, you jump on the heads. But you see how I died there?
Oh, you died. Oh,
look
what,
at that.
What's that? What's
reverse
that?
Time. Yeah. You get there's a time play mechanic where you can go back in time and sort of fix your bad. So if you screw something up and you want to redo, there we go. Okay, so now I'm going to bring this. So now I'll try to jump. But let's say I get kind of antsy and I decide to jump too soon, Matt. And I go, I'm going to get that guy. Oh, no.
No, you missed him.
Oh,
you missed him. Oh,
time travel,
okay.
Back in time. And it has a little cool sound effect, too, as well, doesn't
Instant
it?
Instant redo. I like that.
So here, I'll exit the current world so you can see some more. So here's the different world selectors. So I've only played for a little bit. So here's here's world one. And we'll go in here. Oh, look at that. I get to hunt now.
Ooh.
And you see, just like kind of in Mario almost, you jump on the guy's head to get him, and you get a little extra bounce out of it when you do it. So if you need to get up somewhere, you could bounce off a guy's head. And the gameplay just gets more complex, more interesting. The time play mechanic becomes an important part of the gameplay later on. Right now, it's just like I'm learning, so let me do over. But it later actually becomes an important functional part of the gameplay.
And I love the background, too. I love if you look carefully, like at the sun and the clouds and everything. Everything's dynamic. Mm-hmm. Everything's changing, and it accents, not distracts you from the gameplay itself.
One of the really cool things about Braid is that it was independently developed, and the guy that developed it, he sort of broke the indie market open for a lot of developers on a lot of platforms, specifically like the Xbox platform. And he wasn't the first and he wasn't the only, but he definitely broke it open for a lot of people. And this game was sort of one of like the go-to examples of what indie developers can do. Now that's available on Steam, you can now get it everywhere. And
that's
you could
so
get
cool.
it before from the Humble Store, and I'll have a link to that too if you prefer to get it from the Humble Store. But I think this is a great game. Go check out Braid if you haven't bought it before. Let's see, I'll bring up it on the store page for you here.
Yeah,
it's not a bad price either. It was like $9.99.
Oh, that's just
and
shoot. That's
also, if you remember, I think it was on Tech Talk today. Mm-hmm. Did you know that Good Old Games has launched a movie store?
They did?
Yeah.
Wow.
And they're selling the indie game movie over there, which has a lot about the Braid developer.
It does. And I think it's still on Netflix. It was.
Oh, okay.
Check it on Netflix. Netflix tends to remove stuff, but check it on Netflix. If not, otherwise, get it at GOG.
It's also, I think, on Steam. I think there's a way to pick it up. Yeah. But yeah, I would say check it on GOG's new gaming or new movie platform.
You'll find out about Super Meat Boy, the development behind that, which there was a lot of back and forth there.
A lot of drama.
Fez was, oh my gosh.
Fez, yeah.
Drama behind that was crazy.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
So definitely check it out. It's a great show. Great film.
Braid. B-R-A-D. You can get it from a few sources. We'll have links to those in the show notes. Also, if you're interested in other games, well, there's just so many games to really kind of feature. But one of the other games that we've talked about recently that is out for Linux now is Limbo. This was also ported to Linux by the guest on our show later today. So here's another show, and this is available on the Humble Store, DRM free, for $10.
Nice.
We've talked about Limbo in the past, I think, when we did a roundup of games. It also has a really... Look at that aesthetic.
That is crazy.
Right?
Oh, my God.
Look at how creepy that kind of is, too, right? Look how creepy that is.
That's going to my wish list. It's so there.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Spiders and stuff. That's awesome.
So that's another game ported by our guest. Limbo, also out there. Two great games you guys can check out, especially if you like platformers. I know not everybody does, but I'm old, so that's why I like them.
Oh, my nephew prefers them, and he's 17. So,
really?
Yeah, he prefers old. He cannot stand PlayStation 4, 3, any of that.
Oh, well, I feel a lot better now.
He's got a Super Nintendo. He's got a GameCube. He's got all the classic consoles. He's got everything back to an NES classic. Those are his preferred.
All right. See, I just thought I was an old man, and because I grew up with platformers, that's all I want to play.
He's hardcore like that.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
All right, speaking of something hardcore... Gparted had just hit 10 years old. That's our spotlight for this week. Our spotlight pick is the GNOME Partition Editor. You know about it. I'm not telling you about something you don't already know, but I thought we could take a minute.
Yeah, right.
And because appreciate
we,
10
we
years.
We use it all the time, and we never really stop to think about the history, how important it would be if it was missing.
Yeah.
You know?
I was playing around and resizing partitions on a Chromebook for an upcoming segment on the show, and I didn't even... It never even crossed my mind to use a different tool. Like, it was just, I'm going to use Gparted. Yeah. And when I was putting the show together, and I was literally just using Gparted, and I saw that it was their 10th birthday, huge props. I want to give a personal thank you to this project. Professionally, you guys have been a major resource for me.
Absolutely.
Personally, for all of the toying around I do. It's an awesome utility. And it's, like, a live CD that doesn't have Gparted now is not worth my time.
Oh, I can't function without it. I mean, like, can I do it in the terminal? Yes, but I'm a visual guy. I need to visually see where my partitions are.
That's exactly it too. I mean, you know, if I got to use the command line, obviously you can do that.
Yeah.
And sometimes when you're just setting up, in fact, a lot of times I don't use Gparted for setting up a computer.
Oh yeah, a fresh hard drive. Who cares?
Yeah. You know, it's more like going back and putting a drive, connecting a drive. Like, I've got this Zalman drive. And oh my gosh. In fact, where is it? I didn't bring it in. I wish I could show it. I have a drive that I put the Chrome OS Restore on.
Oh, wow.
Dude, that thing sets up like 8 partitions on the drive.
Wow.
And I had no idea what was going on. And I put it into my USB, I plug it in, I pulled up Gparted, and I saw it all listed out there. And I was just like, oh man, I am so thankful for this tool.
Right?
So here's just a little couple of stats. Over 300 people have contributed to Gparted. Every distribution includes it now. Translators have made Gparted available in 50 different languages. It's used in 220 different countries around the world that they can count. And 17 million downloads just from SourceForge alone. That doesn't even include the stuff that's shipped on the distro disk or from the repos of the distros.
Right.
Just from the SourceForge page, 17 million downloads.
God. That's crazy. But then again, I think about how many times I've downloaded, burned the ISO, and then I need to do it again because I couldn't remember what I did with it back in the old days. I did that frequently.
Chatroom is asking if they take donations, and they do. If you go to gparted.sourceforge.net, they have a donate link up top. Looks like PayPal. Hmm. They do have a list of people who have donated, though, as a thank you.
That's cool.
Oh, look at this. Parted Magic LLC has donated a couple of times. Isn't that interesting?
That's very cool.
That's
great. That's very telling.
Look at several donations of Parted Magic, $100 each time, too.
So apparently they're paying it forward.
A $500 Parted Magic donation. Good for them.
Nice.
So if you like, doesn't look like they take Bitcoin. That's what the chat room was asking.
Yeah.
Or Doge.
Give it time.
They do take PayPal. So there you go.
You know, if Overstock's doing it, these guys will do it soon, too.
Very cool. Gparted, congratulations to 10 years. You guys rock. All right, Matt, let's do the news.
Hey, it's the news, and this episode is brought to you by
Ting.com. Matt, Ting is mobile that makes sense. Ting is my mobile service provider and Matt's mobile service provider, and boom. You see what I got here, Matt? I got a little surprise for you.
Boom.
A Ting surprise, as you might say.
Yes.
So you might recognize this as the Nexus 5.
Sure.
I do.
Here, let me wipe it off for
you. Go wipe off the Chris sweat there. There we go. There you go.
I use my man boobs for that because, let's be honest, it works.
Well, yeah, and you get that good fold in there.
All right, so you're like, oh, okay. So, yeah, it looks like the Nexus 5. Sure, that's cool, Chris. Oh, I hit the power button, Chris. I'm like, boom, Sailfish OS right there. Sailfish OS on the Ting network. What was kind of crazy about this is I didn't really have to do anything to make it work on Ting. Rikai has multi-ROM on here. And you know what's really crazy about Sailfish OS? It's just all about scrolling up. Everything's all about, it's all scrolling. It's all up and down, all the time. All day long, Matt, I'm doing up and down. See, if I go up, I silence sounds. I go down, I got apps. It's incredible. It's revolutionary. But it's awesome. You know what else has been kind of amazing?
What's that?
Firefox OS on the same phone.
Same phone.
On the Ting network.
On Ting.
Ubuntu Touch, same phone. On the Ting network. Android L. This is what I love about Ting. Ting really is about getting out of your way and just letting you have a great mobile experience. That's why you only pay for what you use at Ting. They just take your messages, your minutes, and your megabytes. They add them up, whatever bucket you fall into at the end of the month, that's all you got to pay. You don't pay into some sort of prepaid plan where they're trying to get you to pay for something you may or may not always use. You need hotspot and tethering, you just turn it on. And then it's just data usage. You need to manage your account. They've got an incredible dashboard that beats every other mobile carrier out there. And I can say that because at least in the U.S., I've had all of them. Nobody touches Ting's dashboard. But what's even more incredible is on top of that, even like Ting's lapped them with the dashboard. They've lapped them and they're like, hey, but you know what else? No hold customer service. You call them at 1-855-TING-FTW anytime between 8 a.m. and 8 p.m., you know, human time. And a real person answers the phone, a human.
A human, they say.
And they answer your questions. I know this sounds crazy. I know this sounds like something that can't be done in corporate businesses.
Nope.
I know it sounds like an impossibility. They actually have humans there. And if you go to their site, you can actually meet some of those humans. They've got videos of those humans up on their website, and you can check it out. Go to last.ting.com. Last.ting.com. That's where you've got to go to let them know you appreciate them supporting the show, but also to get a $25 discount off your first Ting device. Last, L-A-S, last.ting.com. Go there now. If you've already got a Ting-compatible device, you can check out their BYOD page. It'll give you $25 credit. While you're there, try out the savings calculator. I've got to tell you, you'll be amazed at what you can save. Forever an end user, he got his friend to switch over, actually his brother, to switch over to Ting by going to last.ting.com, and he said his brother is now saving $120 a month.
Whoa!
That's what he just told us this morning in the chat room. That's just one of many stories we hear from our audience all the time. The other thing that people recognize about Ting when they switch over, Ting is actually a group of smartphone enthusiasts themselves.
Yes, they are.
This is why, just like we used to do around the show, they now have app picks. And this week, the app pick is one that my wife actually finds quite useful. So let's take it away. Take it, Kyra, on our app pick of the week.
Yo, I'm Kyra, and this is Ting's app of the week.
Go, woo! Ting!
We love Yo for its purity and simplicity. What does Yo do? It lets you send and receive messages that say Yo. That's it. There are no social media integrations, no ads, no contact groupings, address book integrations, or anything along those lines. Just add a contact and tap to send a yo. Your own yos pop up in your notifications bar. It's all very binary. Either you yo or you don't. Yos by themselves are without meaning. It's all very existential. Any meaning or context behind a yo is added by the sender and receiver. If I yo my friend, I'm just saying hey. If I yo my boss, I'm asking if now is a good time for that meeting we talked about. If I yo my colleagues at noon, I'm saying, let's go for lunch. There's a lot this app could do, and that's part of the fun, thinking up use cases. The restaurant could yo you when your table is ready. Your favorite blog could yo you when it's been updated. Your kids could yo you to let you know they're home from school. What are some of your favorite uses for yo? Let us know in the comments on YouTube. While you're there, subscribe to our channel for other awesome app videos, unboxings, giveaways, and more.
You can also follow them on Twitter, at TingFTW. You know, it's funny. Apparently, Kyra hangs out with Will Ferrell, which is awesome.
That is very cool.
You know, the chat room's kind of like, oh, yo, that seems like a silly app. So my wife did a show about it months ago on the Faux Show about Yo. And since that show, she routinely is yoing with various audience members. Yesterday, we're out at lunch as a family, out to eat.
Right.
Angela finishes her lunch, and she goes, I think it's time to yo some audience members, and pulls out her phone and just starts yoing different members of the Jupiter Broadcasting audience, and they start yoing her back.
That's
and the
cool.
thing is, the nice thing, and it sounds really silly, but the nice thing about a yo is, like, it's not you asking somebody, hey, check out this link or like this thing on Facebook or what, or comment. It's just, I'm thinking of you.
Yeah.
Or it could be, like she mentioned, you know, you could have a blog that just sends you a yo when there's a new post. And if you want to go check it out, you can. If you don't, you don't have to.
You don't feel obligated. Yeah,
I think it's a great app pick. So last.ting.com, they've got a lot of great stuff over there. Check them out. Go get the savings and also try out their savings calculator to really see what we've been talking about for a while. See why I switched? I now have three lines on Ting, and I love it. Last.ting.com. Last.ting.com. And a big thank you to Ting for sponsoring the Linux Action Show.
Good stuff.
Okay, Matt, we've got to get into this Red Hat hoopla. It has really kind of gotten out of hand. I've never really seen a story about an internal Red Hat political issue bust out like this. I don't know if it was a slow news week or what, but
I'm kind of thinking maybe.
I think your buddy, Stephen J. von Holkoff-Nicholas, over at ZDNet, he got the big headline originally that a lot of people are sort of responding to now. And the headline reads as, Red Hat's CTO unexpectedly quits amid rumors of executive friction.
Good title, because it kind of disclaims the fact that it's all rumor-based. So I'm okay. I'm okay with that title. I don't feel like it was linked back.
The summary, in a surprise move, longtime Red Hat executive Brian Stevens has stepped down from the company as staffers suspect friction in the executive suite. Now, here's the deets, Matt. Stevens says, no one among the Red Hat rank and file even saw this one coming.
Right.
It was shocking and a punch to the gut to some people. And in a short press release, Red Hat essentially said, and I quote, Brian Stevens will step down as CTO.
Wow. You know, you
that was the quote.
If
that
maybe it's just a life thing. Or
and
just,
then there was a little extra context that in the same release. Mm-hmm. The Red Hat's president and chief executive, Jim Whitehurst, said, we want to thank Brian for his years of service and numerous contributions to Red Hat's business and wish him well on future endeavors. Now, some people think there might have been a conflict between Stevens and Paul Kormer. Paul Kormer is the president of products. So you've got the chief of technology officers and the president of products. You could see how those two things might be
they
at conflict. Red Hat employees though, pretty much universally loved him. Stevens has been pretty well known. He worked on Digital's Unix operating system, which in some of his code lives on an HP's True64. He was the CTO at Mission Critical Linux before joining Red Hat. And he also worked on a little thing called X Windows. So you might be familiar with that. So he definitely has a huge resume. A lot of people said he was a great guy at Red Hat. Some suggested that perhaps this conflict and the fact that he sort of didn't really have a path to CEO at Red Hat was frustrating for him. Now, over at eWeek, Sean Michael Kerner says that Red Hat CTO resigned not over strife, but because he had another opportunity. In this very long article where he writes, the actual paragraph says, and this is all we know, I've heard from my own sources that Stevens is not leaving due to any internal wrangling or politics at Red Hat, but other to pursue a new opportunity that he simply could not turn down.
Interesting. Interesting. And I've found that to be true with a lot of technology companies. Usually, once you've kind of hit CTO status, you're there till you're retired. I mean, you're not really going to jump. It's jumping to CEO is such a different role that it doesn't always make sense.
So Stephen J. follows up with reasons for Red Hat CTO departure still a mystery. He points out that with the help of Stephen's technical leadership, just to give you some perspective of how important he was to Red Hat, he helped move Red Hat from being sort of an every brand Linux distro to focusing on Red Hat Enterprise Linux in 2004. That was sort of one of his big pushes. And then in more recent years, Stevens helped lead Red Hat into getting involved with OpenStack and Docker. So he's obviously played some key roles even recently.
And these are big, important roles.
In the meantime, really, despite all of the press attention, no new update from Red Hat. They say the only additional remark that they have made is that they provided to the press is, quote, he's leaving to pursue another opportunity. Stevens himself has not replied to any inquiries. Stevens' eyes may have been wandering elsewhere because of conflicts with Red Hat's product presidents, suggests Stephen. Red Hat staffers will miss him. One staffer commented, he's one of the most highly respected people at Red Hat, and he will be greatly missed. He's genuinely good people. From the business side, Michu Securities, a senior technology analyst, reiterated they are suggesting a buy rating on Red Hat after this news. They say in a note that they believe Stevens, this is according to the financial analyst, they believe Stevens is leaving for another opportunity in the open source space, and therefore they think Red Hat's going to be okay, and they say should be a smooth transition, so they still iterate a buy for Red Hat.
I happen to believe the latter part of that. I think that makes the most sense. If you look historically at his career, he does like challenges. You know, that's what he's into. And so I think you kind of hit a point where it's kind of like, I'm kind of bored.
After 10 years, why such an abrupt exit? Why not
an opportunity? I think if something like spur of the moment, it's like, it's here. If you don't feel it, hey, we got our second and third choices.
I'm having a hard time buying that people at his level are under that kind of pressure. It seems like he would set the agenda and be like, all right, well, I can join your team in a month. I need to have a smooth transition at Red Hat. We need to make public statements about this because we're a publicly traded company.
Yeah,
I am the CTO. This has to be an orderly process for the public. But instead, it was a I'm out.
Now, that being said, because I know people that have done much lower tiers of companies, I've actually done that quick dropout thing that was usually a combination of opportunity and distress. You know, mm-hmm. sometimes a little bit of both, where it's like, you know what, I'm done.
Yeah.
It's been great.
That I would buy.
Yeah, that might be it.
One of the funny comments that is, I've seen a couple different versions of it, but the comment that I've seen online that essentially is, what do you mean you're leaving Red Hat?
Yeah.
Nobody leaves Red Hat. Right. Red Hat is what Google was in the late 90s.
Right, right.
That's a fascinating thing. Like, wow. A lot of people are saying Red Hat is the new exciting technology company to want to go work for, but it's in the early days of that. Mm-hmm. So for somebody like this to leave, I think it's been counter to that new narrative that's building, so it's grabbed a lot of people's attention.
Could be. I think you're probably right. Yeah.
Anyways, we'll leave it at that because it is, at this point, just kind of rumors.
We'll follow it. We'll follow
it. Anyways, good luck, by the way, to Mr. Stevens. And I'm sure Red Hat will do great.
Mm-hmm.
So, John C. Dvorak. Nat, you've mentioned before on the show that John C. Dvorak has a formula that he follows, right?
He has a formula that he follows, and then I always have a video that I suggest everyone listening to me will watch.
Oh, yeah,
watch.
That's right.
It's
I should have found that.
It's very, very important.
Do you remember what it's called?
I don't, but it's Dvorak on Apple, I think it probably will
Dvorak,
bring it up.
Like, admits to trolling Apple users or something like
Dvorak
that, right?
Trolling Apple. It'll bring it up. And he admits wholeheartedly that it's a system that I actually, for a period of time, early in my career, used to get clicks back in the day. He trolls with a purpose. He honestly, between you and me, he doesn't care.
Right.
But he does it for a purpose. He knows that it drives links, and he's admitted to it.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. And that's why, so we're going to keep that in mind.
Yeah. Just understand that. So don't get on the defensive, because he literally has less than zero interest in links. He doesn't care.
So what we're going to do, well, I don't know. I don't know. I think John C. Dvorak would actually be a Linux user were it not for a few apps.
Yeah,
and he calls
them
out.
That's true. That's true. Yeah, because he's so cranky.
So so here's how it starts. And this is why we, on Linux Unplugged, spent some time talking about the Munich thing. So now this Munich story about them potentially switching away from Linux because one guy, the deputy mayor, wanted to start just to look at the project, because one guy wants to review the project, the headlines became Munich is abandoning Linux.
Of course.
We debunked that on Linux Unplugged. It doesn't matter. It now goes on and gets legs of its own. So here's John C. Dvorak. He starts his article out with, there's talk that the city of Munich in Germany, the bastion of open source idealism, will give up the hope and move on from its Linux brand of Linux back to Microsoft Windows. Everyone is trying to understand this with a lot of online complaining.
Mm-hmm.
Well, first of all, we're not complaining. It's not a legitimate story, right? So he says, I use computers to make a living by writing and podcasting. I also produce photographic art as a hobby. I can't accomplish any of this with Linux. Yes, I can kind of get by, but
it. I mean, it's not like you can seriously sit in a Linux box and write articles. Oh, wait, that's right, John. I do it every day.
Well, that part is really silly.
Boom.
The podcasting thing and the photo things, I'm willing to give him some leeway on, but not much. He says, there's a lot of products that I need that I would have to run wine. I've heard him talk about this. He's talking about Photoshop. A chunk of the code that allows a Windows software to run on Linux is not perfect. It takes tweaking. There's all sorts of issues. And more importantly, what's the point? If I have to run Windows applications, why don't I just run Windows? And he's talked about why he uses Photoshop. He says, then, when we have Photoshop and Illustrator in the entire Adobe universe, none of it runs natively on Linux. He goes, yeah, sure, Wine is there, but it's no good. The GIMP enters the conversation eventually. And yes, it is a Photoshop clone that's actually pretty good, but the name says it all. It's hobbled. When I tried to get my own family to use alternative office suites, they rejected every option. My wife, for example, likes the Windows way of tracking and saving all changes in a document and the ability to reclaim old text. Nobody was going for it. I admit that while I do not care about tracking changes, I do like the grammar checker better on Words. Mm-hmm. It needs improvement, but it has good superficial sweep and catches little errors. It's particularly handy for professional writers, many of whom are sloppy and expect the waning army of editors to fix things. I also think Microsoft Spell Checker is better than the alternatives. I actually agree with that, too.
Yes, I'd say when you expand it into grammar, I think that's where it really shines. The spelling's kind of whatever, but the grammar side of it.
You know what? Honestly, I'm such a bad speller that more often than not, Google search is better for me than any spell checker built into software.
Well, and here's a pro tip for Linux guys that want better grammar options. Grammarly.com is a great tool. It's a subscription. It's really high subscription, but if you write for a living, it's going to save your butt and make you not look like an idiot when you write stuff. So, you know, check
that
out.
That's great to know. Grammarly?
Grammarly, yes. Okay. It's worth it.
All right, so here is the nut of the article with the whole headlines based on what everybody's talking about. Mm-hmm. It comes down to the final two paragraphs, really paragraph and a half. He says, time has run out.
Oh, just give it up. We're done.
There Now, this has been a narrative I feel like we've been hearing a lot of lately. So this is really driving me crazy. Time has run out for there to be a must-have killer software package on Linux. Anyone writing such an application writes it for the Mac or Windows, because that's where the customers are. All the super applications for Linux are on the server side, and that ends the discussion. Yes, this could change someday, but that someday is not on the horizon. Right now, Linux on the desktop remains a cheap curiosity. It's kind of fun to play with.
Much like your articles, John.
When you're bored. Exactly.
Well, I mean, I do read his stuff for a cheap thrill.
Yeah.
And, you know, but no, I've always been torn with John. I respect it for his past work. He's a very influential guy back in the day. Then after a while, he kind of fell into a pattern that we're seeing a lot of now, and it's very much trying to, you know, flashy articles, get you to click them, read them, whatnot. I think at the end of the day, we got to realize the fact that he is a Windows diehard Windows user. He hates Mac just as much as he hates everything else. If it doesn't fit into his little tunnel vision, he doesn't care. And that's generally how he works. And again, he's a nice guy. I have no problem with him personally, but professionally, he has a system that he follows, and it's what he's doing here.
Well, and if you actually read through it, and you read through the...
It's designed that way.
What he said is... Linux on the desktop would work, except for these three categories of pieces of software.
Things that affect him and or
his. And if those three things, like for me, word processing and photo management isn't one of them, doesn't affect me, right?
That's right.
So for me, not a barrier to entry. Turns out I have a great desktop experience because I don't need those things. The other thing that he kind of starts to talk about, and then so many people miss this, and this is the logical fallacy loop that a lot of these people get into, is they then proceed to talk about how incredible Linux is on the server, how incredible web services are, how everything's going online, and then they fail to recognize why that fundamentally means those services will eventually be available to Linux users because it's going to be through the web, and it will solve the very problem they're talking about.
Well, and you know, of course, I want to make sure everyone here is aware of that. If Photoshop doesn't work for you on your computer, then clearly that platform is not ready for the masses, because grandma's using Photoshop all the time. And Uncle Phil, oh my God.
Oh, man.
You can't unplug him from iTunes.
Dude, that dude. So, oh, man. You know, and don't even get me started about grandma. She's an illustrator constantly.
See? Yeah. Or publisher. You know, these are specialized tools that a segment of the population uses. There are entire legions of people that don't need this crap.
Right.
They don't.
Great point.
I'm one of them. I can't use Photoshop. It frustrates me. I've been using GIMP since like 1.something. It's just where I'm at, using it for so long.
What? Sorry. Hello. Sorry, I bumped.
So I'm a GIMP guy. I mean, at the end of the day, so I can't do a Photoshop thing.
Yeah, that
I,
makes sense.
You know, it's just what I know. It's my wife. On the other hand, she uses a lot of open source programs, including LibreOffice, and she's a Mac user.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, she would rather gut herself than use Microsoft.
These articles always come from such a selfish point of view.
Yeah.
Right? Like, the rest of the world must be just like me. All right.
And I'm torn because I understand the motivation behind it. I do, but at the same time, I get so tired of it.
You know what? Chat room says...
Get it out of here.
Yeah. So John C. Dvorak, you're out of here.
Brazzies!
All right. So Chase and crew are down at PAX Prime 2014. It's happening right now as we talk. And I said, Chase, swing by that indie booth. See if anybody down there is working on some interesting Linux games that maybe we're not hearing much about. Because we all hear about the big games that will eventually come to Linux. Is there anything you could find down there? And he delivered two great interviews about a couple of great-looking games that are coming to Linux very soon. So we're going to start with a game that introduces a new gameplay mechanic.
Very cool.
Cheating. You have to cheat to beat this game. It is required. So that's where we start with Screen Cheat.
Hey Chris, I'm here at PAX 2014 in the indie booth, and yes, I found something that runs Linux. I'm here with a game called Screen Cheat, and it's a pretty innovative game. Why don't you tell everybody about it real quick?
Sure thing. So Screen Cheat is a split-screen shooter where everyone's invisible and you have to screen cheat. And it's replicating the sort of old-school shooter days, except we're taking that and turning it into an entire mechanic.
So, like what it sounds, basically you have to spy in the other windows, but you also get other help, right? Other help with like weapons, right?
Yeah. So the weapons and the levels are designed to give you the information you need to screen cheat without any physical models of the player.
So tell us a little bit about the development process. It does run on Linux, and you're using Steam to do that, correct?
Yeah. Oh, whoa. That's all right, guys.
That's all right.
Somebody hit the camera.
So we're developing with Unity, and that's really helped us a lot, right? So we can just go like export to Linux, and it's done. Like, we've only had like one problem so far where for some reason the X inputs were inverted. And we fixed that by like changing the way we're handling inputs. But like, it's been fantastic. Like, being able to get it to Linux, like, people have just been like, oh, can you? It's a PC game, but I'd love to play it, but it's not on Linux. We're like, it is. You can play it, right? But so far, it's actually been quite easy to develop, so I guess Unity's really got us all the way there.
That's awesome. So are they able to grab it right now?
Yeah, totally. So if you go to screensheet.com or Steam, you can get the public beta and play for free. Or you can buy it off Steam at the moment in pre-orders. and it's releasing October 3rd.
Well, that's awesome. Sounds great. There you go, Chris. Something that runs on Linux here at PAX. Screen sheet. Back to you.
And we'll have a link to that in the show notes, too.
That's really cool.
Isn't that a neat idea?
And I want to know what the game's going on in the background.
That was screen sheet.
Yeah, I mean,
that
was what I gathered. It looked like it was very fast-paced and high-end.
Okay. Cool. And it's very social because you have to cheat by, you know, punking the guy you're playing with.
I like it.
The next game that Chase stopped by at the indie booth is a combination of like a smash 'em up arena type game and a card game at the same time. It's got a couple different elements to it.
Interesting.
And this would be a great one if you're watching the video one to check out because they got some great gameplay capture of it and also available for Linux.
Nice.
Hey, Chris, and everybody there at Linux Action Show. We're here at PAX Prime 2014 at the Indie Mega Booth, and we're checking out a game called Hand of Fate that, yes, runs on Linux. Hey, we got Morgan here. Morgan, how you doing?
Very well. How you doing?
So Hand of Fate, it is a card-based game, but it's got a little twist of adventure in it. Why don't you tell us about it?
So basically what happens in Hand of Fate is you build up a deck of cards that then forms like the dungeon floor that you work through. But every time you have an encounter, it can be a straight narrative encounter, or it can be an action encounter. And if it's action, it all turns into a 3D world. All the cards you've earned fly in and equip your character. And then it's like an action brawler, like a God of War or Arkham Asylum style.
So why don't you tell us a little bit about the development process. You said it is going to be available on, or it is available on Linux through Steam Early Access, correct?
That's right.
What'd you develop it on? How'd you do that?
So it's developed in Unity. And we launched on Kickstarter in December of last year. Since that time, we've worked really closely with our community. So we roll out builds every month, started with backers, started with like the alpha backers, then the beta backers, and we're now all the way through to early access. We've had Linux players on from day one, and they've been fantastic in terms of giving us feedback. We've worked really closely with them to tweak it for their systems. And we're now at the point where we've got a really good and stable Linux build. And people can check it out now.
Awesome. Well, talking about checking it out, why don't we check out a demo of this game?
Sounds great.
They both look like some really neat.
That last one is really compelling. Mm-hmm. I mean, because it was so unique in that it's a thinking man's game, but at the same time, you get to go back and slash.
Exactly. You get a little bit of both. Yeah. So we'll have links to both Screen Sheet and Hand of Fate in the show notes if you would like to go check those out. And thanks to Chase and crew down at PAX 2014 for grabbing those for us. That was some good stuff. I think they're having a good time. Yeah. I think it's a big PAX this year, a really big PAX. And while we're talking about games, now would be a good time to go talk with our guest, who is not the godfather of Linux gaming, because he's not old enough to call him a godfather.
No.
But he's certainly been one of the key figures responsible for getting the Linux gaming industry to the state it's at now,
right,
for getting support for Linux gaming fundamentally for some of the core technologies, and also for just establishing a marketplace and for bringing so many of those great games over here. So I think that's a great spot to end the news. So Matt, we'll wrap up the news for this week. We'll go chat with Iculus. If you've gone down to PAX 2014, we'd love to see pictures of anything Linux related you saw down there. Go over to jupiterbroadcasting.com, click the contact link, choose Linux Action Show from the drop down, and in the subject line, please put PAX 2014 one word, so that way I can search for that. I'd love to see that stuff.
Nice.
All right, Matt, that's all the news for this week. We're about to talk with Ryan C. Gordon, a.k.a. Iculus, perhaps the godfather of gaming. If you've played a Linux game recently, you probably have this man to thank, or at least there's a good chance. And we're going to pick his brain about the past and future and the current state of Linux gaming. But before we get to that, I want to thank our segment sponsor, System76. Go over to system76.com right now and get yourself a rig that's built to run Linux. No more fighting with the Wi-Fi drivers or Bluetooth or sleep. Go get a machine from the beginning, from inception, was built to run Linux, and they ship it with incredible support. And right now, they've got back-to-school specials. I've got the Bonobo Extreme. This is my gaming rig. It has been for over a year. And I love the fact that I've got a rocking NVIDIA card in this thing, and I never am fiddling with that aspect of it. I'm always getting right down to what I want to do, which is often load up a Steam game. And when you're over there, check out their laptops. Look at the back-to-school specials. Also, the desktops. The Leopard Extreme would make a killer gaming rig. And last but not least, they also have servers. So if you're looking for an end-to-end solution, this is great for education, great for small businesses, go check out system76.com. Get yourself a machine designed to run Linux, supported to run Linux, with a long-term path. And we're talking years of being able to run different Linux distributions on this thing right out of the box. System76.com, and tell them the Linux Action Show sent you. Matt, how excited am say we have Ryan, a.k.a. Iculus, on the Linux Action Show? Ryan, you're one of our guests who I've wanted to have on for a really long time, but I needed like an excuse to ask. And so PAX is going on this weekend. Braid just hit Steam for Linux on, I think, Friday. It's a big week. So, Ryan, welcome to the Linux Action Show.
Hi.
Hi there, and thanks for joining us on a Sunday from your family's house. I really appreciate that. So,
so we put up the kitschy picture.
Yeah, I like that. Nice. I was gonna say we have a background here. You've got a background there. It's good. I wanted to start for those in our audience who are maybe not totally familiar with things beyond when Steam was announced for Linux. I think a lot of people think that that's when Linux gaming started, is when Valve said, here's Steam. But it turns out there's been certain folks that have been behind the scenes, sometimes not so behind the scenes, working on gaming for Linux, like yourself, really since the 90s. And I don't know if this would be the best place to start, but Matt and I were both huge fans of Loki software. I mean, we threw so much money at Loki. And so I think maybe people have heard the name. They don't know what it is, and maybe they don't know really why it was important, and really how it was sort of a heyday of Linux gaming back in the early 2000s, wasn't it?
In many ways, it was Linux gaming back in the early 2000s, right. The very, very late 90s. For those that don't know, there was a company called Loki Software, and they only did one thing, and they licensed AAA big hit video games for Windows from Activision and, you know, big companies like that, and they would port them to Linux and sell retail box copy for Linux, and literally try to be selling in retail stores and stuff like that. So you could go out and buy a CD with, Civilization called a Power on it, or Heavy Gear 2, or, SimCity 2000 was on there at one point. They did, I think, close to 15 games. I can't remember. It was like 13, I think, was their total. That's an unlucky number. Maybe that was what happened there. But they had some problems. They had some business problems, and they were very early to a market. Like, I mean, they might have been a decade early for what they wanted to do, and they couldn't sustain the business, and they made some business mistakes too, and went out of business, and poof, were gone. And a lot of people think of commercial Linux stuff. That's what they think of for video games originally is Loki. They had a big staff of some of the smartest programmers they could find, myself excepted from that. And it's funny, like you go to conference at computer game conferences like GDC and E3, and people still talk about Loki, and they're like, I never ran Linux, but man, those were some smart motherfuckers out there, man.
Right, yeah.
And you can see them now. Like if you were to follow them, a lot of them are like, one of them works for Activision Central Technology, which is like they parachute into a project, rescue it, and parachute it out. And that's all they do. It's like there was a massive bug in Call of Duty. This guy came in, fixed it, and like the Lone Ranger rode right back out of town, And but other ones are shipping.
And not just talent, though, right? Other things came from Loki Software that are still sort of a key part of Linux gaming today, right?
Oh, absolutely. And this is it's easy being an employee that, was there when they were going out of business. It's easy to be bitter about what they did wrong, but there's a lot of things they did right. And one of the things they did right was they took all these tools they needed to build because they just simply did not exist. Mm-hmm. And they built them and they open sourced them, and they were open source all along. It wasn't like, oh, Hail Mary passes there going out the door. But many of those were incredibly useful for a full decade after Loki was.
Would that be things like SDL?
SDL is still incredibly important, but other things like how do you install software when you don't know if it's going to be Debian or Red Hat?
Right, the Loki installer.
We called that Loki setup, and it was GPL software, and we wrote it from scratch.
Loved it.
And then the people that still needed it, like me, like after I left Loki, I'm still porting video games to Linux, we did Unreal Tournament 2003 and stuff like that, among other things. And the great thing about installers is that you don't think about them until the night before you ship, and then you find all the bugs in the installer.
There's
a single game we shipped with Loki setup a full 10 years after Loki went out of business, where we weren't still like, we need this feature added. We never had a game that was more than 4 gigabytes before, and then you find out there's a 32-bit integer you're overflowing in the installer, and things like that. Yeah. And those were useful for an incredible amount of time. But the one thing they did, that the best thing that Loki ever did, was a piece of software called SDL, Simple Direct Media Layer, which we use. It's kind of like DirectX for Linux, kind of. It's not actually DirectX.
Right, because it doesn't replace OpenGL.
It complements all that stuff. It makes it easy to build a game. It hides all the ugly stuff from you that you would have to worry about on an X server, heaven forbid, or ALSA, right, or Pulse Audio and stuff like that. And it takes care of all that for you, makes it easy, and it makes it portable. And we've spent thousands of man hours improving that. We're about to go past our 10,000th commit in the revision control system for SDL.
Wow.
Valve has hired the main developer on that, and it's not his full-time job, but he's still working on SDL frequently, and then there's a whole army of other people improving it, and it's driven by the needs. We need to make games that do incredible things, and you know, this open source project has, you know, been there to help us all this time, and we improve it and give those changes back to everyone, and everyone wins from it.
So one of the things that a thread I feel like I've been picking up on a lot is a lot of developer discontent with OpenGL. And I'm wondering if maybe this wouldn't be a moment if you could touch on your thoughts. Obviously, this is an area you have some experience in. It's particularly in Linux. Is OpenGL, is it hopeless? Does it need to be thrown out like Apple and Microsoft tell me it does, and AMD?
No, it doesn't need to be thrown out. And this is important, is that it will never be thrown out entirely, because there's always going to be games, including some of those Loki games from the late 90s, that use OpenGL and won't be updated. So we're always going to have it.
Right.
And there's lots and lots of books written about it, and lots of documentation and code examples. So throwing it out entirely, you don't need to do that, and it won't ever happen, I think.
Yeah.
That being said, that doesn't mean you can't replace it. I mean, we're always going to have access to that layer of software, but... But what you're seeing from everyone, not just OpenGL, what you're seeing from DirectX, or Direct3D 12, which is the next Direct3D, what you're seeing from AMD's Mantle, you're seeing from Apple's Metal,
right,
is that they're going to something much more low level. And that's actually really a blessing for game developers and for everyone, I think, because... Mm-hmm. So the OpenGL that you would have used in the 2000s and in the 90s was what was called the fixed function pipeline. I don't know how technical you care if I get here.
Go for it, man.
Yeah, definitely.
The fixed function pipeline was a lot of, like, you set... these states, you know, I need this thing to alpha blend, I need this thing to, you know, do this transformation on it and draw this polygon with this texture, and you know, you set all these states and you tell it to draw, and it does a lot of math on all that data you gave it and figures out what should eventually be spit out onto the screen. And that was good when it was very simple, like I just want to draw like a little teapot spinning around or something like that.
Or a gear.
But that really, really became an albatross around everyone's neck, and Direct3D was like this too. Both the major 3D APIs were like this.
Sure.
That became a real albatross where there's so much state you can set, and you don't have to set it all. You tweak the bits you need, you don't touch the other things, and sometimes they interact in really strange ways that you aren't really thinking of. Mm. And it got to the point where somebody has this in their email signature, and I always like this, that when you're dealing with OpenGL and you're dealing with Frisbee tricks, you can't really promise much more than, hey, watch this and see what happens. So,
I like that.
I gotcha.
It's true, because, you know, inevitably everyone's like, okay, I set everything up and I drew this, you know, rectangle on the screen and nothing happened. Oh, you know, the camera's pointing the wrong way, or oh, you forgot to enable this level of bitmaps or whatever. There's so many things that can go wrong, and they're not really errors, because the horrible thing about computers is they do exactly what you tell them to do.
Right.
Definitely.
Much to our own detriment.
So it sounds like there's absolutely a need. My concern is, what is a Linux user's salvation? Because Windows has the next version of DirectX. Apple could eventually move Metal over to Mac OS X, maybe. Probably not, but maybe.
One thought about Windows real quick here.
Yeah.
They have their next thing, that's true. But Windows 8 people have it. And one thing we've seen recently, because Unreal Engine 4 is now the big new Unreal Engine.
Right.
And they still target Windows XP with that.
Right.
But if you want to use Windows XP, it defaults to OpenGL, because that's the only way they can target older versions of Windows. So keep that in mind. And that's one of the reasons we won't get rid of OpenGL.
It's almost their own anchor in a sense. They can't move beyond it.
Well, the biggest curse, the biggest problem Direct3D has is Microsoft.
Is Mantle Linux's only salvation from the perils of OpenGL? Because that doesn't feel like a great solution. I mean, it's a good solution, but it doesn't feel like a great solution for everyone.
Well, let me finish my answer here.
Sure,
this is important. Okay. So the fixed function pipeline is complicated, and we threw that away. I mean, it's still there. You can still use it. But now we use the programmable pipeline, shaders.
Okay.
And it used to be that you had to become this, as things got more and more complex, you had to be this real OpenGL ninja. Remember all the different states that could be set and how they could interact and all the different extensions that could screw with that and stuff. And all that got thrown away. Fixed function pipeline's gone. You could still use it, but mostly you turn it off and use shaders. Mm. And suddenly, it was much easier to be a graphics programmer. You could do more complex stuff, so you still needed those graphics geniuses. But there was this democratization where it's like, you know how to program. Watch out for some gotchas, but basically you say, here's my numbers. I calculate these numbers. Eventually, they become a pixel at the end of the whole pipeline.
Yeah.
But more or less, you could see what it was doing and you controlled each of it. There was no mystery to it, you know, and I think that's good. But even that is becoming more complex as time goes on. So Metal and Mantle and DirectX 12, what they've basically done is say, take out all the other framework stuff so you control everything directly. You still have shaders, but you don't have to worry about these states over here. Basically, all the rest of the states are gone. You don't have to worry about what thread you're doing it from. You can do what's best for multi-threading, et cetera. And it becomes a much simpler prospect. It's much lower level. You have to do some more work, but you have a lot more power over it and a lot less complexity.
Mm-hmm.
And that's true of all of those next-generation APIs. Now, they're talking about something right now called OpenGL Next. That's just the generic code name for it. And I don't know what it'll be, and a lot of people are going to make this decision, and Lord knows they can get it wrong. But theoretically, what we'll end up with is, here's your old OpenGL Core API. It's still there. You can still use it. But OpenGL Next will give you something like Mantle or like Metal or DirectX 12. And, you know, very low level, very simple. You get all the power of the hardware, and it stays the hell out of your way. That's probably where we're going with OpenGL. And what they won't abandon is things that have been really valuable for OpenGL, namely the extension system.
Mm-hmm.
There's a guy named Eric Lengel who is kind of famous in the OpenGL world. He's written books about OpenGL and stuff, and he has his own little engine. He's made the C4 engine, and he had a problem. He's like, I have these shadows I'm drawing in the engine, without getting into too many details, and I'm getting, you know, some artifacts here I can't deal with. And the way you would deal with this particular problem is to use this feature in Direct3D, which has never been in part of OpenGL.
Mm-hmm.
And 5 days later, on Twitter, an NVIDIA engineer said, I have just fixed your problem. Use this extension now. And wow. It's in the next driver update for NVIDIA's driver. So poof.
That is kind of awesome.
Try to do that on a multi-year cycle for Direct3D. If that feature's not there, it's not coming.
Right.
So,
that is kind of killer.
Yeah, so and that's important. We need to keep that. And so the next generation of OpenGL, whatever it looks like, will be probably a lot like Metal and Mantle and stuff, but it will also include that incredible extensibility, which gives you that power to add features that you didn't think of or you didn't know you needed when you designed
the API. It wasn't an idea in the marketplace, and then a few years down the road, all of a sudden we need this. So if we were to look at the current state of technologies on Linux, and let's say somehow, if we take away the user-based problem, because that's either going to happen or it's not eventually, and if say we had users, and there was lots of...
It's already happening. I just wanted to throw that out.
Well, that's where I wanted to get to, actually. It's like, assuming the users are starting to come on board, which I have the sense they are, and I'm sure you must have a very good sense of that, what else is, technologically speaking, like OpenGL or sound subsystems, what is the biggest barriers that drive you crazy when you're porting games or writing games for Linux? What are you still like banging your head against the table and think, gosh, we have to have this fixed?
Well, the thing that is always the biggest problem is the 3D API. And it's not that the functionality is not there, and sometimes it's not. But like I said, there's been a lot of extensions to OpenGL where it's like, oh, we can do this in Windows, and we just, you know, the hardware can do it, because if I boot this into Windows, it can do it. But OpenGL extensions over the years have been coming like machine gun fire to, you know, solve those problems. And that's helped a lot. But
you can't always rely on extensions. So I hear a lot of developers saying, well, I know that you could do this as extensions under Linux, but I can't depend on those extensions being there, so I won't target for those.
Time solves all problems, though. And there are things where it's
nice.
As someone who's been doing this for years, I'm still like, I don't know. I should check to make sure they have at least OpenGL 2.0. What if they're still on 1.2, which is like 1998 technology?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, there comes a point where you have to be like, I'm sorry, this game won't run. Get a better
run. Yeah, you want to do modern gaming, then step up. I think especially, too, when it comes to certain types of gaming, I think that's actually legitimate because the medium has to move forward. So
yeah, of course. And what was I going to say? And, you know, if you're doing something very small, like if you're doing Angry Birds, like, the technology's there. You don't have to worry about it. If you're doing Unreal Engine 4, you might find right now on Linux that your best bet is to have an NVIDIA card with the closed source drivers. But even there, the best thing I've ever found for fixing a problem in a video driver is shipping something that doesn't work with it. And the open source people are, like the open source developers, like if you're talking about NVIDIA, like they're and AMD, they're concerned about fixing their bugs and they fix them in a timely manner, and we appreciate that.
Mm-hmm.
We really do. But the open source people, man, they do not like it when a game doesn't work on their drivers. There are lots of games I've shipped that don't work on, you know, Intel's open source drivers on the first day. And by day 3 or 4, man, it works great. It works great, you know, because they look at it and they're like, well, it's a little embarrassing. They want to fix their problems. Two, they don't know they have some of these problems until, I mean, everything needs a test case. And especially the 3D drivers, there's so much complexity that it's like until, you know, Unreal Engine 4 broke this, we didn't know it was broken. No one's used it. And then, you know, Ian from the Intel team or whomever from the AMD team will come in and just be like, boop, 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 fixed it, had test case, done. And, nice. there's been things where it's, you know, you think, well, there's no way they could ever do this, but I'm looking at the Nouveau drivers, the open source re-implemented, like reverse engineered NVIDIA drivers, and they're doing incredible things with that. Like, I would have never thought that project would get off the ground. I thought that would be like one commit of a readme file in SourceForge. But they've, I mean, you can run shaders on those things. You can, I mean, it's amazing how far they've gotten. And every time a new game comes out that doesn't work, you shouldn't think of it as, oh, this game doesn't work on, you know, the open source drivers. It, what you should say is this doesn't work on the open source drivers today.
Yeah.
Tomorrow it probably will. Then,
right. So. Yeah. I like that.
And that has gotten better every year, release after release. And
now,
you know,
you touch though on, you know, it's almost a point of pride. They're motivated to fix on them, and you are.
If I had to summarize, they give a shit about their
Right, exactly. And I think you are able as an independent developer to recognize that as an asset to that platform. I don't know that EA has the ability to recognize that as an asset. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, I could see how it's appealing to indie developers, but that's not something that really brings over the huge development shops. Is that a problem, do you think?
I'm going to say no, but yes, I do think that between indie so I'm not even going to say indie, I'm going to say smaller game developers and big developers, there's a difference in quality control. And there are games that I could ship as with indie developers or even just small commercial developers that were it's like, well, this doesn't work on 50% of the GPUs out there, but they'll fix it soon enough. They're like, okay, whatever. Whereas EA might be like, we have a checklist, and it needs to fix. It needs to work or have a workaround on these systems. But workarounds are a waste of time in this particular case because, like, it's a problem that's going to solve itself as soon as you ship. So I haven't run into that problem in great detail, but it's certainly something I have seen before. But the thing is, fine, nobody sees EA towering, lumbering over here as fast as they can to port Linux games. So, you know, it's let Unreal Engine 4 push the hardware as hard as it can and let other games come in and try all sorts of weird experimental stuff. Right. And then when those drivers stabilize, they can show up. Yeah. We'll wait.
Yeah. We'll wait till it's obvious that they're not here and that they should be. So why don't we talk?
So worth noting, Wine fixes a lot of those things too, because people run the Windows version, it goes through the OpenGL drivers, and that will often trigger a lot of the same problems. So
in all honesty, do you see, looking back at as long as you've been doing this, do you really see this as, I don't know if a turning point's the right word, but a new era of desktop gaming for Linux? Is this really something new? Are you seeing a lot more developer interest? Are you getting people contacting you saying, hey, what would a project like this look like? Is that happening?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And the thing is, and you have to understand, you have to choose your friends carefully, because I always get contacted by email and phone calls and stuff like that asking for Linux ports, but I'm getting a lot more contacts now where they're asking for SteamOS ports. And so you have to decide if that's okay. SteamOS is literally no different from Linux. If you upload a Linux version to Steam, that's what they give you on SteamOS. It's not like you do a separate build for it.
Right.
And there is no, like, how do I detect SteamOS? You don't. You just build a Linux version of the game.
So you're thinking you're okay with that? Because I've been wondering the same thing lately. Because I noticed, did you see this week that MSI announced a new gaming motherboard, and on the box it says SteamOS support and with a picture on there. And I thought, wow, now we're seeing SteamOS support on gaming motherboards.
I think it's surprising to me. I'm not sure how I feel. Part of me is concerned by that, but part of me also wants to think if the commercial face of Linux gaming is SteamOS, then that's... there is no commercial face of it. Like, if gaming sucks on a Mac, you talk to Apple. You know, if it stinks on Windows, you can look at Microsoft.
Right.
Who do you blame for Linux problems?
Right.
You know, who do you talk to? You know, it's like you and me, we're very good at saying, okay, we know if the bug is in this package or this thing, you know, you go talk to Bob, who maintains that package.
Exactly.
But, like, as terms of, like, customer support, you don't call Bob, you know?
Right.
It's like, it's not...
Yeah, that's always why I thought Ubuntu did really well, is because at the end of the day, a company like Google could know that if they had a big problem, they could probably get Mark Shuttleworth on the phone and say, Mark, you got to fix this. This is Larry, and this is important. And
alternately, being Google, you can also just do your own distribution called Android.
Yeah.
And
There it is.
They don't on the desktop, though, interestingly.
Well, and I have one thought along that I've run into on Steam frequently is you have a lot of people that they're new to the Linux scene. They release a game as developers, and they're saying, hey, this is a great game. Go ahead and buy it. Okay, I bought it for Linux. Oh, yeah, that Linux thing. So we don't really – we support it. You can go to the forums here. We know it's a bug. Screw you.
And screw you again. And by the way, we're probably never going to fix this. But, you know, go ahead and keep buying our stuff. I drive that. It drives me nuts because I see that more and more frequently.
Is that what we're doing here?
You know, and so, no, I don't mean like all developers. I mean just like certain, yeah, some
or
guys.
Actually, you know.
And usually it's people that develop for Windows that kind of like do a Linux port. That's usually where I'm finding
that. So, Ikas, we just did a couple of interviews at PAX 2014 this weekend. And a lot of them are like, oh, yeah, we have Linux support. And they'll even have like a picture of Tux up on their booth.
Right.
And then you talk to them about it. And they're like, yeah, well, really, we launched Unity. And we noticed there was a Linux export option. And it just builds it for us.
That's it. And that's usually what these people
are.
And
we submit it to Steam. And like, and like it just does it for us.
I mean, I feel like they're posers. They're not like you to where you're actually doing it. I mean, they're just like.
What are your thoughts on all that?
I guess, are you asking me if this is a good thing or a bad thing?
Yeah.
If it's if it's them being lazy or are they just inept?
Is this going to be a problem?
I mean, yeah.
Like, are these tools, because of the state of Linux and how many people are on it, where these tools are, like, everybody wants just the easy option.
Yeah.
Are you worried about sort of like a bad rep?
I don't think we should penalize people because it wasn't hard enough for them.
Okay.
I think I played, I don't know if you played this game, there's a game called Gone Home by the Fulbright Company. It was a big indie success. And it's very good. If you haven't played it, it's totally
it's very good.
Simulator ever. I was prepared to hate it, and I really found I loved it.
Don't you love that?
It's built in Unity. As far as I know, they have no Linux programmers there. I played the entire game with no problems on Linux.
Yeah, okay.
And I think it was simply like Steve over at the Fulbright Company clicked the Linux button and posted it to Steam. And he's like, I don't know anything about it, but if it works, great. You know, and it worked great. And I would not get a Linux version of that game.
Yeah.
I would have been putting onto Windows to play that game, or maybe Mac OS, I don't know, if that button didn't exist in Unity. So, and Unity is very kind of far from the metal. Like, you don't really get that down and dirty in Unity. It's kind of more of a higher level thing. You write in C# for the most part, and there's a lot of really great tools in it. So, generally speaking, you aren't going to have an option to put something in there that's going to be really screwy and non-portable.
Okay.
For the most part. So in many ways, that means they've given a better development environment, a safer development environment to allow for that cross-platform magic. And I think it's a good thing. I do think that you're right. There's going to be people that hit that button and go, if you have a problem, man, you're on your own. I don't even know what to tell you about it.
Like, yeah, totally.
Like, I don't even run Linux. I don't even know.
Yeah. Well, and there have been a couple people that really felt badly, and they're like, I'm really sorry. I'll do everything I can, but I don't know what to do. And that's cool. It's like, okay, just at least address that you give a crap. I mean, that's all I ask, you know. And there are some people that did that, too.
To those people, if they're watching, there are people that will help you fix that.
Yeah.
Like, if you have some stupid problem, like it just doesn't work with
you. You need a parachute guy.
You need the parachute guy.
But for things with Unity, the problems are usually very small and easy to fix. And a lot of it's like, well, just there's a lot of things you don't know how to do right until you've done it wrong before. And, you know, I've made a whole career of doing things wrong. So, you know, there's other people like me that will be able to help in those cases.
Nice. Spoken like someone who truly has experience.
Right,
very much so.
But Ludum Dare, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. Ludum Dare, it's a game jam. The 48th of these, apparently. Or 30th or something. It's 48 hours you build a game. Everyone picks up Unity and runs with it. And I'm seeing a lot of Linux versions of those little like weekend game jam games that came out where you're like, I hit the Linux button. And now you have this big pile of cute little like experimental pieces of art.
I'm not trying to disparage Unity. In fact, Rashard, I think is how you say it. I've really enjoyed that little platformer game. It's a Unity game. Sure. So kind of in the same vein, just because, you know, now that you're here, I got to put you on the spot to make sure that everybody can, of course, take issue. No, I'm kidding. People will totally. Just in your opinion, what about the situation, say, like with the Witcher, where it's wrapped in there? It's not wine, but it's kind of like wine. And for some folks like me, it ran flawlessly. And for some other folks, it was horrible. And the big narrative we saw was, oh, is Linux just going to be the bastion of emulated games? It's just going to be the Windows wasteland of games. And everybody was freaking out for like 2 weeks.
Sure, sure.
Is it a big deal? What do you think?
I'm going to say it's not a big deal. But the thing is this. I feel like a lot of people behave really poorly about the Witcher thing. And it's like you have a new technology, and I'm not saying I don't really know anything about what they did with it. I know it's wine-like, but I don't know that
it's like an Eon wrapper they call it or something.
Yeah,
whatever it's called, but
some
like
brandy thing.
Yeah, like anything else, this is a very simple software problem. You have a whole millions of lines of code you bring to a new platform, and there's going to be some bugs. Now, the concern, and you had mentioned this before, where it's like, you know, someone poops out a game, they're like, okay, it's done. Thanks for the money, sucker.
Yeah,
you know,
right. Yeah, totally.
That's a bad attitude. Yeah. You want to absolutely make examples of those people.
Yeah.
But what I have seen with The Witcher is that they had a really bad launch because it's a whole new platform they're totally unfamiliar with, and they should be applauded for wading into the pool. That's not like that's not like getting thrown into the pool to see if you swim. That's like getting thrown off a cliff to see if you fly. You know, and and they kind of flappy bird along there, but they didn't abandon it at that point. They're like, we shipped it, move on to the next thing. It seems to me that they are in fact interested in making fixes.
Yeah, they're improving it. Yeah,
they should get your thanks and they should get your cooperation. And if you feel that you get the product you want eventually, they should get your money.
Yeah, I actually enjoyed playing it. I bought it. I think it looks beautiful. See, I mean, part of it, too, is a lot of times I think people don't really appreciate how abstracted things are in development. So from a casual observer, they say, what? That means it's some sort of abstraction or emulation. That's atrocious. When in reality, a native game could be doing something like that in the background and people have no idea.
True.
Well, and the thing is, you frequently you see somewhere in the middle. Like, for example, all the Source Engine games from Valve, they have a native OpenGL renderer, but as far as the engine's concerned, it's talking to Direct3D. They just rebuilt the tiny little pieces of Direct3D they needed using OpenGL, and ironically, it turned out faster than the Windows version. But that's not emulation, but inevitably, someone gets a crash dump. They're like, why is there a Direct3D symbol?
Right.
Like, you know, why is this called this Direct3D? Not an emulator, but you know, it's a good technical engineering decision to say, we have this code that's 10 years old. It doesn't make sense to destabilize it, because remember, they still ship updates every week on Windows. I mean, Half-Life 1 got an update a couple of weeks ago. So, I mean, it's not like they ever stop shipping these things on Windows. Yeah, the poor Alfred at Valve still has Visual Studio, Visual C++ 6 on his desk, so he can ship updates to Half-Life 1 and Counter-Strike.
Oh, you're not kidding, are you? You're not joking.
That is funny.
I mean, Valve is an exceptional case in this, because most people don't care that much about these games, but they're very, very hardcore about keeping everything running and up to date. But they're not going to move it to a newer Visual Studio. It's like, you don't want to destabilize it. You want to make small fixes and keep everyone happy instead of making massive changes. So, what was I saying this for? So to answer your question, you have a whole spectrum. You have people that are like, I don't want to deal with this. Give me wine or whatever. And you have developers who are like, I don't even like dynamically linking with stuff. I'm statically linking everything, you know? So you have two different viewpoints. You have, and I don't know which of those is hardcore. I guess the hardcore is the people that statically link everything. But these people over here would never, ever ship a wine-based product. It's just that would offend their techie soul, you know? So I think you are going to see there are going to be wine or whatever they used or some emulator type thing for some products. It's going to happen. It's inevitable.
Do you think it's more for legacy products?
Oh, especially for, and the thing is, it's not like people are like, what the hell? System Shock 2 is using DOSBox. Unacceptable. You know, I mean, it's need it for archaeology's sake, if nothing else. But you can see a definite roadmap of how this has happened before, because Steam for Mac shipped before the Linux one by 2 years or something like that.
Yeah.
And there are some things on it that are based on wine or cider or Sedega or whatever people used on the Mac. And the vast majority of things are native ports. And a couple of things that were based on cider or Sedega or whatever they're calling it took their game. I'm thinking of X3 in this case.
Okay.
Took their game and did a native port. And they got better performance and they're happier with it. And they weren't beholden to another company to make sure their game kept running.
Yeah.
So you can see there's a lot of different ways this shakes out, but I think overall you usually get native ports.
So you think it's part of the stage that we're in right now?
Oh, absolutely. This is absolutely evolutionary.
Yeah.
You're going to see things where people won't need to get products fast, and that's part of the hype of SteamOS, is that everyone wants to get this thing up there right now if they're going to do it. And that often doesn't lead to a good product. But again, you reward the ones that get good products and stick with it and keep making it better. You know, it's you find out, oh, they just wrote to the, you know, dot game name in your home directory. You know, it's like, they didn't know. They read something about Unix that was written in 1970. They don't know.
Exactly.
All right.
You know, so, you tell them, they go, oh, crap, we didn't know. We fix it. Next patch. And, you know, if only we had a system where you could send updates to everyone that owned the game.
And distribute it to all the people that bought it. All right. So that's our current stage. Should we talk a little bit about the future? I would love to pick your brain. What is near term and long term in your likely going to happen scenario of the future of gaming? Is SteamOS, are Steam boxes going to work? Are we actually going to see people switch over, or are we just going to kind of maybe move a little bit farther than we are now, but mobile has got it from here on out? Sorry, desktop, you lost your chance.
I don't know.
Profound, sir.
Drum roll.
But this is what I do know. You can never tell what's going to happen in the future. And I get asked that a lot. It's like, and I'm not psychic, and I'm wrong about everything. I was in a cab driving to WWDC in like 2005 or something like that. And I was talking to somebody on this phone waiting on my way to the convention center saying, Apple will never get rid of the PowerPC. They've invested way too much in it.
Oh my God.
And I didn't know that I was driving over to be told that they're switching to Intel.
Wow.
And so
you never know what's going to happen.
And there's someone pointed out a Slashdot interview. I was like, Valve's never coming to Linux. Just stop talking about it.
You know?
I've been wrong about everything. But you can look at things that have happened in the past and understand how that might extrapolate out to the future. The Ouya, how are you pronounce that? Ouya, the little $90 console, survived its Kickstarter and was not a total disaster. I don't know I would call it a success, but I've seen if you walk into Target or Kmart or Walmart or something like that, Ouya, I can never pronounce this, I'm sorry.
I can't either, don't feel bad.
Ouya-like things, where it's like, this does nothing but play Android games. But this is not a console you've ever heard of. It's what your aunt would buy you for a birthday gift if your aunt wanted to seem cool but doesn't actually know what a kid likes. You know what I'm talking about? And you look at things like the NVIDIA Shield and every Amazon thing they announce every week, which is always based on Android. And it's like, everyone's like, oh no, there's a million Android devices. How do you support them all? This is a great fucking problem to have because the worst people on the planet to deal with when shipping a video game are Microsoft, Sony, and Nintendo. Why are we so desperate to make sure that everything is an Xbox world or a PlayStation world? Right. What I want is an Android world or a Linux world or something like that where you say, you got to make sure, you got to do some sanity checks to make sure it will generally work everywhere, but more or less it works everywhere. Mm-hmm. And you go and you buy the unit that you want to play on. And that Ouya, that thing will fit on a shelf.
Oh, yeah.
Like it's
the size of a coffee cup. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, it's tiny as hell. And the NVIDIA Shield or a tablet or whatever. I think even you look at the PlayStation 4, the thing's gigantic. You know, it's like, where you put that in your house? But the point being that SteamOS could be very much that same thing. They've clearly seen the Android model work. And I love the iOS people because they do not understand that they are the minority market and they think that Android is a complete failure.
Right, yes, of course.
But it's not.
No,
you know, it's,
surprise.
Everyone's
huge.
Got an Android phone.
It's huge.
An iOS
yeah.
phone, but the vast majority of the planet that has a smartphone has an Android now.
Is that good for Linux? It's great for Android. Is it good for just general Linux?
I think Android's different enough from Linux that you have to call them separate products, even though they both happen to use something like the Linux kernel. But I just use that as an example to say that you have this democratization of hardware.
Right, yes.
You know, you're no longer beholden, and you're no longer beholden to, you know, the ridiculous certification requirements of Microsoft and Sony, where you pay them, you want to make a one-line fix to your program, that'll be $30,000 in 6 weeks.
It's totally not even an option for most indie developers.
Yeah, exactly. And you've seen it more and more where indie games that are on there are like, I'm just sorry, the bug just has to live because I can't afford to do certification. Mm-hmm. You know?
And really, that's one of the reasons why Braid was kind of such a huge deal, right? Because it was the beginning of this, wait a minute, this isn't a company that has billions behind them in funding that's all of a sudden launching on the Xbox platform. This is a guy launching on the Xbox platform.
Well, to be fair, Braid costs like $250,000 to make. So just to be fair.
No, all right, that's good perspective, yeah.
According to John Blow. But there have been cheaper games that have made it there.
Yeah.
He did certainly set a trend. And anyone that's seen Indie Game the Movie, you could tell that the guys that did Super Meat Boy were flatly starving before they managed to ship that thing.
Yeah.
So who knows? But
I follow you though.
But what I think you're to get back to the original question, after all this backstory, what SteamOS is going to do is basically say you're going to have a console like you do, you know, your Xbox or your PlayStation, but it's going to be whatever you want in terms of power and performance. If all you want to play is Angry Birds, you do not need to have like quad video cards in SLI mode in your computer. Don't pay $1,000 for a game console. You know, pay, I don't know, you know.
300,
I mean, hell,
whatever.
Yeah, 350,
maybe 99 one day. Who knows?
Yeah, sure. Well, probably 99 one day. And they'll probably be very, very clear. You will not be playing Black Ops 2 on this machine.
Right.
Exactly. Surprise.
Or you're going to use streaming. I mean, there's the streaming capability.
Well, streaming, I don't know. Yeah. I think streaming is a really cool idea. I don't know how much use that's going to get in practice because I think we're more and more going to higher resolutions of video and more Wi-Fi and less cables. And that's going to be very, very hard to solve.
Yes.
That being said, very smart people are working on it at Valve. Namely, the guy, the SDL guy that they hired. That's one of his main projects.
Cool.
Is building that.
So, that's awesome.
But we'll see how that goes. That's also another option. But I think you're going to find that there's a lot of people that don't want an Xbox because it's big and expensive and you need a subscription for it and blah, blah, blah. And also, there's this real stigma that's starting to be attached. Like, someone's like, oh, I went out and bought an Xbox. Oh, that's cool, bro. You're going to play Halo with your boys?
Right, yes.
Right.
It's not as bad as that. But, you know, it's
starting.
My mother would never buy an Xbox.
Right.
And but I handed her an iPad, and she loves the games on it.
I think, the other thing that's really key about what you're saying, I think the being able to buy the rig that is most appropriate for you, because I can't tell you how many people in my – essentially every person in my family who has bought a Wii console or an Xbox console, they play it really seriously for a few weeks, maybe a little bit longer, and then for the most part – it pretty much sits. Maybe they buy one or two other games for it, and it kind of just sits there, and it doesn't get utilized. But if they could buy a $99 piece of equipment that would play casual games for them that they didn't have to have a reoccurring subscription for, that maybe could do other things too, which would be nice, like media playback and things like that. I could see how that could be huge, huge, huge. And if that's Linux-powered, well, then everybody wins, don't they?
Sure. And I think this is what Valve is gambling on with SteamOS, is that there's two concerns they have. That one, they want to make sure that, well, obviously they want to cut the console money. Who doesn't, you know?
Sure,
but also they're running into this problem that every platform they run on, that they ran on, past tense, is moving towards these walled garden
with
app
stores. Yeah.
And which is funny because I guess Steam is also that. But they're getting to a point where Apple wants you to install Steam or whatever through their app store, which you can't.
Right.
Who would do that? But once you install something through their app store, they want to get 30% of everything you sell on it.
Mm-hmm.
Everything looks like DLC to them. It looks like an in-app purchase. So, and Valve does not want to give them that money. Also, Valve does not want to be told how their Steam should work or act or behave, etc. And the problem is Apple's been incredibly badly behaved about this. And you can make arguments in favor of Apple. Like, there's a lot of concerns. There's a lot of things that the iOS App Store solved. Like, you don't have to worry so much about malware, theoretically, and you don't have to do this and blah, blah, blah. Okay, fine. But they've been really badly behaved people in regards to this. And the problem is that Microsoft looks at everything Apple does in modern times and misunderstands it and picks out the wrong lesson from it.
Amen to that.
So, so what they will do is get their Windows Store wrong, and you can already see this happening, but they will absolutely make sure it's locked down, that you have to give them a cut of anything you sell and blah, 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 blah. So you can understand where Gabe Newell's concern comes from in this. So that's why they started working with Linux. And, you know, they have a whole team of Linux people over there now that are everywhere on the range from, you know, they have the guy with the picture of Richard Stallman with kissy marks on it. And, you know, see, the people are just like, I just don't like the business that that we're being forced into, and we want to make sure we have options. Like, every range of that spectrum is there working on it, and they're all believers in what they're doing, and they're hoping it's going to make the world better, and it's going to make the experience better for consumers. And SteamOS is just another extension of that. Like, once you have this, once you're freeing yourself from the platform of Microsoft and Apple, then why not let people run it as a console? Why not break into that market? Why not destroy that market if you can?
Absolutely.
Can they destroy it? I don't know. I think it will be probably also run. I could be wrong. I've been wrong about many things before, but I think that it's going to go forward. I think it's going to do some good. I think it's going to, you know, open up opportunities for consumers that aren't there right now.
What about the possibility that it sort of shakes out, like you mentioned earlier, the iOS Android situation? iOS has a tiny percent of the market, but a lot of surveys show ad developers make more money in that store still. Maybe SteamOS will have a small percent of the market, but the people who buy are going to be more likely to buy because it's a system more tailored to their specific needs.
It's possible. The problem we're going to find, though, is the statistics are going to be totally bogus, because what you're probably going to find, realistically, is people have 1,000-plus games in their Steam library that they used to play on Windows that now they can play here.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of people are going to be like, what you'll probably see is people going, we're not getting a lot of new sales, but we're getting suddenly the surge of people playing our games again.
Right.
And maybe we'll now sell more. But people are going to have a massive back catalog showing up, which isn't good for developers, but it's great for consumers. I mean, is the Xbox One even compatible with any of the 360 games? PlayStation 4 isn't.
I don't think so.
No. I'm not 100% on that, but I'm not sure,
but I don't
think so. Could you imagine a game I bought in like the mid-2000s will probably work on SteamOS?
Right. I love that. So, I mean, I'm really excited about it.
You never lose your catalog, whereas there's this planned obsolescence in all game consoles.
But not only that, but you can take your SteamOS and drop it on the hardware you choose, not the one that Valve says, okay, you need to use this box. No, you can put it on whatever you want, essentially.
I like that. Or my desktop.
So you have to understand you're still stuck with closed-source software
in
both SteamOS, parts of SteamOS, and some of the games you're playing, although not all of them. There are GPL games on Steam right now. but
that's actually kind of my next question. I have two last questions for you, and then I'll let you go because it's Sunday morning.
Okay,
so as a long time, I don't know if you consider yourself an active Linux user, but as at least somebody who's worked and you know uses Linux all the time and worked on Linux for forever, pretty much. How do you feel about the closed proprietary aspect of essentially what you do work on? How do you reconcile those two things? You know, I also struggle with those things in media production.
Okay.
I'm a big believer in open source. I love having an open source platform and a free operating system. But I recognize also there's a spot for proprietary software on top of that. But I'm wondering where your thoughts lie on the matter.
Well, I mean, I have always been a believer in free software even before I had before I even knew that term. I was giving out source code to stupid little things I had written when I was a teenager, and it's like, and
nice.
it wasn't because I believed in the freedom of it, although I do. But it was also like, I wrote this thing, I learned something from it. Here's the source code. If you learn something, that is incredible. You know, that's a huge benefit to everyone.
Yeah.
And then from there, I stumbled into Linux. I was like, oh, these guys get it. You know.
Nice. Yeah.
Meanwhile, I mean, Richard Stallman's been doing this since before I was born. But you know, it's. I thought I came up with it. I don't know. But,
all good developers do.
Totally.
So as an individual, I believe that's important, and that's why I always open source everything I can. And I fight with companies. I don't fight with them. You know.
You advocate, though.
I am always encouraging companies I work with to open source their stuff. And some games have been open source because I pushed and pushed and pushed. And I actually have one I'm working on right now. We're about to open source.
Oh, wow.
You'll find soon.
Cool.
But so I'm always pushing in that direction, but I also believe you really shouldn't be a dick about it. So games are really in many ways disposable. So like if it comes to the point where your word processor doesn't work anymore or your web browser, you're in a world of shit.
Right.
But
right.
if, you know, Unreal Tournament 73 doesn't work anymore, okay.
There'll be another game one day.
Yeah, so in terms of concessions, it's not a concession I'm comfortable with, but of all the concessions that one has to make, I'm willing to accept that, and we just keep pushing to get things open source. And you do see these things come over time. I'm not militant about it, but you keep watching, and people get it, and you keep encouraging them, and they get it. And we saw, you know, John Carmack released the source code to Wolf 3D and Doom and stuff like that under the GPL. Not just here's the source code, but here it is under the GPL.
Yeah.
And other people took that hint, and they ran with it. Duke Nukem 3D from 3D Realms, that is a direct came out under the GPL, and that was a direct cause that was directly caused by John Carmack's action. So that was a positive example.
Yeah,
but but even still, you look at Unreal Engine. I mean, it's not GPL, but they're like, it's in GitHub. It's literally in GitHub. If you pay them for a subscription, they give you a login on their GitHub account. And you clone from there, and you can push.
It's true. That's a huge shift. That's a ginormous shift.
It's a massive shift, and if it works for them, you're going to see everyone else do it too.
Yeah.
And the thing is, I don't know if they changed this, but I only looked at it in the first couple of days, but GitHub has a missed feature that it will show you everyone that has access to a repository. And I'm sure that if that's still true, they're going to fix that eventually because there's people you don't know are working on Unreal that probably don't want you to know until they're ready to announce something. Mm-hmm. Like if, you know, I don't know, id Software suddenly had an account on there, you'd probably be like, I wonder what they're doing with this.
Right.
You know, but at the time, a couple of days after they announced that, $20 a month, you get the source code.
Mm-hmm.
There's 8,000 subscribers to it.
Wow.
So this is
that's a hit,
and some of those are curious people. Some of those are AAA companies, and this is their source code access to Unreal. But all of those people are getting this in their ear now. They're all seeing that this is something that can work and be beneficial to them and to everyone else too.
Yeah.
So
that is exciting.
So it's a sea change, and I'm hoping that more positive examples like that will start a real avalanche down the hills. So,
I think we are starting to see that
definitely
happen. Okay, so you kind of teased us a little bit. Is there any projects you can share that you know about or are working on? Any NDAs that you don't care about that much or anything
NDAs,
like that?
Nah.
If I tell you things I'm working on and they don't ship, then next time I come
here, my gosh,
you'll see about Unreal Tournament 3.
Right.
Why did you tell us about that?
So what I'll have to do is I sometimes on your Twitter feed, I get a sense that something's coming. Maybe like a goat-based game, a goat simulator. I'll get a sense of something coming.
we finally shipped Goat Simulator, and Sanctum 2 just shipped too. And we have bug fixes we're still doing to those games. But Coffee Stain Studios, who did both those games, were incredibly patient. It took a long time to get around to doing those projects and putting the effort they needed into them. And I'm hoping it's paying out for them now. But I do keep a Trello board of stuff I'm working on publicly. But it's such a tease because it's like unannounced project one, unannounced project two. So, but you can keep watching those.
It's crazy.
Those
well, and their Goat Simulator beta has been running great. I especially like Godzilla Goat.
That's freaking great. Like goat, with the rocket pack? I mean...
I have an Australian Shepherd dog, and he's crazy, and I think that someone needs to make a mod that puts, like, Australian Shepherds
right,
into...
Right, yeah, totally.
It would just be a one-to-one mapping yeah. with the destructive goat.
But, I'm all about that.
All right, I know what I'm doing tonight, then.
I do have a very interesting game shipping within the next day, a couple of days or maybe a week or two, so keep an eye out for that.
All right, where would be the best place to watch for that announcement? On your Twitter feed?
My Twitter feed, if you can take all the social justice warrior crapola I spew, it's at Iculus. You can
Okay. We'll have a link to that in the show notes. Also, embedded in the show notes is a talk that you did semi-recently that goes into more detail about the history of Linux gaming. Very good talk. Very enlightening for people who are kind of curious about all of this from not just the technical standpoint, but the historical standpoint, too. So that'll be in the show notes. Link to your Twitter profile. Well, Ryan, thanks so much for coming on the Linux Action Show, taking a little bit of time on your Sunday morning, and stay in touch. Let us know as things come up. Maybe we can talk again sometime in the future.
And thanks for doing the stuff you do.
Yeah,
really
thanks.
Appreciate
yeah,
that.
Really. Thanks for the years of being awesome. Yeah. As a Linux gamer, I really, really appreciate it. So big
well,
thank
I
you.
Well, I try to be
too.
Awesome, so I'm glad you noticed.
Thank you. Absolutely. Needs to be called out. We really appreciate it.
All right, Ryan. Have a great rest of your Sunday.
You too. Take care.
Thanks.
And that brings us to the end of this week's broadcast. But hey, Matt.
Yeah.
Before we get out of here, we got a physical mail item.
Oh, my goodness.
It came in from producer Q5Sys, and it's either a bomb or a Raspberry Pi-based Tor router. I'm not sure.
Well,
so here's
exploded
box.
Yet. So.
Hey, what do we have here? Oh, look at that. A Raspberry Pi Model B.
There we go.
You want to open that up while I'll pull out more stuff here from the physical mail sack. You can mail us stuff, too, if you'd like, but... I don't really know where we have the address posted. You'd probably just email Angela at JupiterBroadcasting.com. Ethernet cable. All right.
Flash drive.
USB cord. Oh, you got SD. Oh, good, good. Oh, nice. 32 gig. Ah, here's the Pi case. Got the Pi case.
Got a slice of pie.
And here's the power adapter. So I bet you all of the software is right here on this little itty-bitty SD card.
I'm going to say probably so.
Very cool. I'll start playing with this tonight. Thanks, Mr. Sys. And if you back the Kickstarter project, yours is probably coming very soon, too.
There it is.
Very nice. Very nice. Hey, Matt.
Yes.
You know, if I wanted to do a little reading, maybe I just felt like I needed to chill out a little bit.
Yeah, you want to do some
Where
reading.
Would I go?
Usually we're putting up articles every couple of weeks over at datamission.com. Scroll down to Open Source and hit the linkage there. Otherwise, you can actually go to the show notes and just click on my authorship articles.
Oh, well, how easy is that?
How convenient.
It's like we did that to make it easy for them.
Absolutely.
And, although maybe like if you're an anti-reader and you like to maybe visually be entertained, always an option for that too, isn't there, Matt?
We actually have a little bit of a show that we put on. We're going to shoot for weekly again, maybe even bi-weekly after a period. And we basically take Linux games, whether it's native Linux or in Wine, and play games. And in this particular case, we're playing, I keep wanting to call it
Shank.
Stab. Shank.
Shank, though, right?
Yes,
it's
Shank.
Great game.
Yeah, it's a really, really, it's like playing a graphic novel.
Yes.
With more chainsaws and axes and guns.
Yeah, that's a great one. So you can check that out, youtube.com/geekandthegamer. Also, don't miss Matt and I, both of us, every single week over at Linux Unplugged on Tuesdays.
Right.
Last week, we wrapped up more of our LinuxCon 2014 network interviews, including the software networking, which is the one I was the most excited about. Lots of good stuff from LinuxCon, as well as Noah's impressions. Microsoft's Munix Man is the one where we debunked the Munix story. So if you've been hearing that Munix is dropping Linux, go listen to episode 54. And this week, episode 56 will be on Tuesday, just after I record a special edition of Coder Radio.
Very nice.
Because Monday in the U.S. is Labor Day, no shows on Monday, taking that day off. So Coder Radio will be recorded on Tuesday. That also means no Tech Talk today on Monday this week.
Yeah, a little bit of a break.
Prepare your bodies for that. But then that means we'll be back and more refreshed than ever.
Tuesday.
I think that's how that works,
I think that's how that works. That's what they tell me.
I'll give a special plug, too, for the Faux Show, which we're recording here in just a few minutes on the live stream. You can join us live over at Sundays, 10 a.m. Pacific, jblive.tv. Go to jupiterbroadcasting.com/calendar to get that in your local time zone automatically. And just after the Linux Action Show wraps up, the Faux Show starts. This week, it's faux products from the audience. You guys have sent in a Jupiter Broadcasting-based product, and I've been told they're amazing. It's a really cool Faux Show to catch, so that'll be out probably late Sunday our time.
Yeah.
So usually the same day lasts out only later. A few hours later for editing and things like that. And we'd also like to get your feedback, linuxactionshow.reddit.com. Submit stories, suggestions, comment. We'll have a thread for this episode, anything like that. Also, linuxactionshow@jupiterbroadcasting.com. Okay, Matt, is there anything else we need to cover before we
think that's it.
All right, everyone. Well, thank you so much for tuning this week's episode of the Linux Action Show. See you right back here next week. get the freedom. You don't have the freedom fever, do you? If you're hearing an eagle, that means you have freedom fever.
I've had other kinds of fevers, but I never had the freedom fever.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's a bad sign, Matt. If you're here, if you're hearing, yeah, there's no eagle in the studio. So if you're here, could you imagine having an eagle in here? So if you hear an eagle, that means that you have freedom fever. Sorry.
I feel the need to go monitor somebody. I don't know.
It spreads quickly, so you just got to be careful.
Captain's log. Start 821-555-555-555-555-555-573-555-573-555-573-555-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-5-